Morning. Amen. Why don't we just give the Lord a big hand clap of praise and thank him for being here today. Amen. Look at your neighbor and tell him you're glad to see him this morning. Amen. Ask him if they're going to worship God with us for a little while. Amen. Let's worship him today. Hallelujah.
Thank you. because we have been set free by the blood of the Lamb. Amen. Praise God. So good to be in the Lord's house on this beautiful Easter Sunday. So honored and blessed to have each and every one of you here today. Beautiful congregation. Look at all these beautiful young girls up here on this front. Amen. Woo! So glad to have every one of you here today. And our live streamers, we're glad to have you here in person this morning. We've got some live streamers here that watch on live stream, and that's great, but we're glad to have you here in person today. Amen. We are blessed. We are so blessed. But let us remember today, we'll be having a little program after our Sunday school lesson, and then we will be going out to the outside and having an Easter egg hunt. We're going to be giving away things, so don't leave. Hang on. But it's more than the Easter eggs. It's more than giveaways. As Jesus was carrying that cross up that old rugged hill, women were gathered around. The Bible said they were weeping and wailing. And he looked to them and he said, "Weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and for your children." I believe that the Lord was telling them and telling us also that I'm doing this for you. I'm doing this for you. Even to Pilate, he said, "Do you not know that I could call 12 legions of angels down and they would deliver me? But for this cause came I into the world. I came to die for you. I came to give my life for you. Not only that, to prove to you that I am the resurrection." He arose from the dead, and we have life today because of that. Amen. Can we give the Lord a hand clap of praise right now and thanks given to him? Praise God. Amen. We want to do the request today. We didn't really have any, but there are multiple requests. We have people that are really sick, not able to be with us today, that have cancers, and God's able to wipe cancer away. Heart disease, God's able to mend it all. Broken hearts today. I'm glad I serve a God that can mend every broken heart. Can we pray right now together in the name of Jesus? Lord, we love you, and we praise you, and we honor you, and we are thankful to be in your house and with the people of God. Lord, I'm glad to be among the living. I'm glad, Lord, that you rose from that old rugged grave, that old cool, dark grave, and brought life into this world, brought life into men and women, young and old alike. Lord, I know you're a healing God, and I know you're a miracle-working God, but above that, you are a broken heart healing God. Heal every broken heart. Touch every sinner, every lost soul. Don't let them die lost. Let them be saved, I pray, in the name of Jesus. Bless in this house today. Bless your children. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Would you look to your neighbor and say, "It's so good to be in the house of God with you today."
Amen, amen.
When has impossible ever stopped you? Friday's disappointment, and Sunday's empty tomb. Since when has impossible ever stopped you? This is the sound of dry bones rattling. The praise make a dead man walk again. Open the grave, I'm coming out. I'm gonna live again. This is the sound of dry bones rattling. Pentecostal fire. Run out of
praise. Hallelujah. There's a scripture in the Bible that talks about all the things that's not going to make it into the kingdom of God. And he talks about the adulterer, the fornicator, all this stuff, shall not inherit the kingdom. But then there's a follow-up scripture that says, and such were some of you. Such were some of you, but you've been washed. You've been sanctified. Amen. Aren't you glad he can make a change in you? Amen. Aren't you thankful for the blood he shed that we would have salvation? Amen. Amen. What an amazing God. Amen. In one of the scriptures, he was even praying. He said, you take this cup from me, but thy will be done. I want your will. And he carried on through the cross because he looked down in 2021 and he saw some people that still needed it. Amen. Aren't you thankful? Aren't you thankful he looked ahead and saw that we needed salvation? Hallelujah. What an amazing God. Amen. We're going to sing a couple of old school about the blood. Aren't you thankful for the blood he shed? Hallelujah.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood.
Oh, sing it with me.
Of Jesus. What can make me whole?
You know this verse.
Say, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? There's nothing but the the blood of Jesus.
Oh, precious is the blood that makes me white as snow. No other found I know. Gives me strength for victory from day.
us love him right now across this place.
Oh, come on. I believe he deserves a little bit more worship than that. We're talking about the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, who robed himself in flesh and dwelt among us and died so that we could have life. Amen. Aren't you thankful to be serving that kind of God? You know, many people would look at blood and shy away from blood because blood isn't something that is personified as beautiful. But when you think about the blood that Jesus shed, it becomes beautiful because it was for the remission of our sins. I'm thankful to be serving that kind of God. So honored to have each and every one of you that are here today. Greet one another around you. Say hello to your neighbor. If you don't know him, introduce yourself. We are so honored that you are here today. A bunch of excited kids around here looking forward to hunting Easter eggs. They're chomping at the bits, can't wait for Sunday school to be over so they can go find that egg. We'll be dismissed for our classes at this time. If you are a guest here, we encourage you to go to our Sunday school department. We have some amazing teachers, and they got some great things planned today. Just send them toward the back. They'll make sure they get in the right classroom. Amplify students will be meeting. If you're 13 years old or older, you can go out this side door. They'll be meeting in the student center. The rest of us will be in here. Sometimes our holidays get so busy and out of whack that our mind is going in 100 different directions, and it's hard to focus on the little things. It's hard to focus on being with family because you're worried about the meal that you've got prepared or hiding the eggs and all this stuff. But Easter is about so much more than that. And as we dive into the word of the Lord this morning, and we ask that God would speak to us, let us try our best to focus upon for 30 minutes here, 34 minutes left, to see what God would say unto us today. John chapter 19 and verse 19, this one verse of scripture, says, "And Pilate wrote a title, and he put it on the cross, and the writing was this, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." The King of the Jews. I want to preach, teach for a little while this morning. No ordinary king. No ordinary king. And I want us to do something a little bit different than what we normally do on Sunday morning teaching. We usually just step right in and teach. But I want us just to bow our heads all across this house and let's pray today that God would minister to every individual that is here today. Would you do that with me today? Lord, we love you. We're so thankful, God, for this day that's set aside, that we celebrate the day of your resurrection. And God, we pray that you would speak to us, that the King would show up in this house, that every individual that was here under the sound of my voice within these four walls, that you would speak to us, let our hearts, let our minds be open and receptive in what you're trying to say. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Amen. A king was born. Never before had this happened. Prince and princesses have been born, but never a king's been born. Babies that had eventual rights to the throne came into the world screaming at the top of their lungs, but no one stepped into the world as a baby that had the title king. But this king did, because he was no ordinary king. He came into this world in the womb and had the kingdom and had dominion from the very first day. They didn't shut the hospital wing down at Bethlehem General Hospital and post security guards at the doors as they anxiously awaited his arrival. But the birth of this king wasn't even in the five-star hotel down by the lake. Even the local inn that advertised those weekly rates that you would only stop there if you had to was full. The king's mother and the king's father, doing the best that they could, found just an empty stable. I mean, I understand their dilemma. This was all new to them. They had never seen a king be born before. They never experienced this, and so it was new to them. And so they began to give birth to this king, but he was no ordinary king. His mom may have looked around for a royal robe to wrap this special baby in. She couldn't find it. It wasn't servants there waiting upon their beckon and command to do the will of the father and the mother to take care of this special king. But there he was in an inn, backside of an inn on a stable. It wasn't special advisors to tell mother and father, well, this is how you treat the king, because it's new. Never has there been a king born. So she wrapped him in what she found there in the stable was swaddling clothes. Announcements of his birth wasn't sent out to all four corners of the earth. There wasn't royal treatment. The paparazzi wasn't out camped outside the stable snapping pictures. Can't wait to see the new king. No, it wasn't like that at all. Only a few smelly horses watched his arrival nonchalantly swatting at flies as they buzzed by their ear, not realizing the miracle that was taking place at this place of time. A king was born. But he was no ordinary king. Meanwhile, a few miles away, there were some shepherds keeping watch over their flock, and they were just doing their job, and all of a sudden, out of this mundane, ordinary, job-filled night, an angel appeared, and a light shined down from heaven. And the angel began to speak to these shepherds. His message was direct. Today's the day that the Savior is born. You know, the one that you've been talking about and you've heard taught about through Scripture all your life. He's arrived today. He's arrived today. Today's the day the king has finally arrived. All of Jerusalem had anxiously awaited his arrival. Maybe they were expecting a halo when he appeared on this earth, a halo to be around his head. Maybe they expected his skin to glow. I don't know. Something surely would have to signify that this is the King of Kings that we've heard about, that we've talked about. It's going to be something special, but no, he was just a baby boy. Born into this world, looked like any other ordinary baby, born into an ordinary family. But this king was anything but ordinary. This king was special. How then would these shepherds know where and how to find the king? How would they know in a city filled with thousands of people there to pay their taxes? How would they know which kid was the one that was to be the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords? Bethlehem was packed, and so if the new king looked like any other baby, then how would they were to pick him out? But the angel said unto them, this shall be the sign unto you. This is how you'll know that you found the King of Kings. This is how you'll know you found the baby that's to be crowned king and victorious king at that. You'll find him wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Why was this swaddling clothes so important? For you see, these were no ordinary shepherds as well. They were the elite forces, you might say, of the shepherds, the best of the best. They didn't keep just ordinary sheep. These were the shepherds that raised the sheep for the priest to sacrifice. These were the shepherds that kept the sheep and raised them up and presented them to the Levitical priesthood. And the Levitical priesthood would then take these lambs and lay them upon an altar and sacrifice these lambs for the sins of those around. But what was so special about that wasn't just because they supplied sheep to the greatest entity there known in the tribe, but it was because there could be no spot or blemish on these sheep. These sheep had to be special. And so it was when they were born unto them, they had to look them over, make sure there was no cracked hoofs or discolored fur. They couldn't have a cut or an abrasion on them. They had to be without spot or blemish. They had to be a perfect lamb. If they were going to sacrifice this lamb for humanity and roll the sins over to the next year, then they had to find the perfect lamb. And that's what these shepherds did, was watch these. Now, sheep aren't the smartest animals. They had to be watched. They had to be protected, because even if the perfect lamb was born, they had the perfect color, the perfect size, and no spot, no blemish. It could accidentally get hurt. It could get its leg caught in a branch. It could scuff its knee on a rock. It could do a lot of things, so they had to protect them at all costs. They had to watch those perfect lamb and watch them every moment of the day. The process would begin at birth. They would look this over and find the perfect lamb. And because of their clumsiness, they would take these narrow bands of cloth and wrap it tightly around this lamb for its protection. They called this cloth swaddling clothes, because the perfect lamb had to be protected. The perfect lamb could not get hurt, so they put this cloth around him and called it swaddling clothes. And so the angel would look to them and said, you know, this is going to be your sign, because you'll go and you'll find something. You'll find the perfect lamb that's come to take away the sin for all humanity. And you'll find him wrapped in swaddling clothes. I've protected him. I've brought him for this moment. I've put him for this time. That's why John would declare, behold, the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world. That's how they knew that this was the King of all kings. He was no ordinary king. It wasn't like anybody else that was king over their kingdom and king over their city. Kings have power. See, kings speak, and they begin to answer. Whatever he commands to happen, it has to happen. As the king, we live in America. Thank God we are not sitting under kingship. We're not under the beck and command, because they could come take your house, take your land at any point in time, and it's about to be that way as it is. But the kings could just say something, and his servants would run and do it. How nice would that be, men? I know your wives don't do that, that you could say, I'm thirsty, and all of a sudden, within a few seconds, there would be a drink placed in your hand. Make me a sandwich, and boom, they would go make you a sandwich. Kings have power. They speak and make it happen. But reality is, earthly kings are dependent. Their power is dependent upon everybody else submitting unto them. If you decide to revolt against the king, and enough people decided not to give him power, then they could just have enough, and the king would lose all power, simply because their power is based upon those that are around them. Their power is based on whether you obey them and follow their command or not. But this king's different. He's no ordinary king. His power is not based upon whether I'm following him or not. His power is not based upon if I'm following his every whim, his every move, and his every command. No, he has power, and it's not based upon mankind. If he spoke, it wasn't that men listened to him, rather that the heavens listened to him. If he said something and it came into existence, it wasn't because those around him made it happen. It was because he spoke, and all the heavens stood at attention when this king began to speak. He would stand up on a boat in the middle of a storm while the disciples were scared for their life, and he would walk out and begin to say, peace, be still. And even the wind and the waves began to calm down at the words of this king, because this king's no ordinary king. You see, other kings, they could say, stop raining, but they couldn't make it stop raining. It would continue to rain. But this king was different. It's no ordinary king. That's why the disciples would say, what manner of man is this, that even the wind and the sea obey him? Because he wasn't just a man, nor was he an ordinary king. His power was not based upon ordinary things, but supernatural things. Oh, he did have followers. We know that he had followers. He called them his disciples. Other kings had great warriors and men of great esteem to follow them, but not this king. He had fishermen and tax collectors that walked with him. He was different. He could speak to the elements and cause them to change dynamics. He could speak to the ears that were attached but yet stopped up, and they would open and they could hear again. He could command the dead, lifeless body to rise up and have life again. And it would happen just as this king would do. Life would appear back into these bodies. He could also make something out of nothing. For you see, I can take some lumber, maybe build a dog house that a dog could seek shelter from the rain. But there has to be lumber, and there has to be nails, and there has to be a hammer for me to make that dog house. But this king doesn't need something. He doesn't need substance to make something happen. And he can take nothing and make something out of nothing. That's why he stood in front of time, before he ever robed himself in flesh, before the world was formed, before the earth, the trees, the grass as we know it. There was nothing here, nothing but emptiness and void. But the king spoke, and he said, let there be, and there was. This is no ordinary king. I don't know if you're sitting here in this building this morning and you feel like you've got nothing left. You don't even have a substance to offer God to say, here, God, would you take this and make something out of it? God, I stand before you with nothing. My life is shattered. My dreams and hopes are gone and all this. But let me tell you, I serve a God that can step into nothing and speak, and something begin to form and appear out of nothing. Because we serve a king that's not ordinary. We serve a king that has all power in heaven and in earth. He can take what's broken and make it whole. He can pick you up from the bottom and put you on top of the world. I don't care if you're facing addictions this morning that you can't seem to get over. You tried different 12-step programs and different things, and you can't seem to overcome it by yourself. You tried to abstain from it. You tried to get away from those people that deal with those addictions that cause you to want that thing. But let me tell you, that we serve a God that's able to break you free from addictions this morning. I don't care what you're going through this morning. We have a king that's able to come on the throne and show up. Most kings on this earth, they seek a throne, but this king came not looking for a throne, he came looking for a cross. It was his plan from the beginning, because this is no ordinary king. Isaiah chapter 53 and verses 3 through 5 says, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as we hid our faces from him, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we are healed. What kind of king would do that for you? What kind of king would let them take a crown of thorns and pierce them on his head for you? What kind of king would let them take the cat of nine tails and rip flesh off of his body just so you can find peace and find healing and find help? I'm talking about a king that's no ordinary king. He isn't like every other king. He came so that we could have a life and have it more abundantly. Healing still being poured out this day and age that we live. Why would God robe himself in flesh? Why would he step off the throne in heaven where he had no pain and no sorrow, only to come down to earth and pick up a cross? Why would his spirit take on humanity only to allow himself to die? Why would he abandon the heaven where angels worshiped him and only to arrive at earth to be greeted with shouts that said, "Crucify, crucify"? I tell you why he came. He came for one word, and that is redemption. He came to gain possession of something in exchange for a payment that he could only pay, that spotless lamb. Most kings would see what they could take from you, how you could help them, but not this king. He came so that he could give you and how he could help you. This king's purpose was to save you from your sin. The devil may have lied to you today and told you you're worthless and that you've gone too far and you've messed up too much. But I'm here today that we tell you we serve a not so ordinary king. That this king came to save you. This king looked at you and said, "You're worth dying for." This king looked to where you are even this many years away from the cross. He looked at you and said, "You know what? I'm willing to give my life for you." And I'm a firm believer that if you were the only person on earth, that God would still went through with his death just for you. Just for you. The Bible says that he could even call 12 legions of angels down when they were saying, "God, why are you doing this?" He said, "Do you not know that at any moment of time I could call 12 legions of angels down?" I looked up how much a legion was, and it come up 12 legions was 72,000 angels. 72,000 angels that have more power in their little pinky than what we do in our entire body could come down and could have wiped everybody off the face of the planet Earth in a moment's time. But God said, "Hold on." I could picture them standing on the edge of heaven saying, "Let us come. Let us protect you, God. Let us come down or we'll wipe them off." And God said, "Hold on." He paused all of heaven just so that he could carry his old rugged cross up the hill and give payment for you and I, so the debt for our soul. What a cost. See, there was only one payment that was sufficient enough to wipe away a black heart coated with sin. 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 18 says, "For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things, as silver and gold, from your vain conversation received by tradition from your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of a lamb without blemish and without spot, a perfect king, a perfect king that would come down and save us from all unrighteousness. Paul said, for you are bought with a price. And what a price that was. He first not only robed himself in flesh, but he was betrayed by a close friend of his by the name of Judas. Betrayed. Not only then was he betrayed, but he went on trial, only to hear those that he'd walked among screaming, crucify, crucify. The lips that were not able to talk, but when he spoke, those lips began to talk. There was the lips that were saying, give us Barabbas, give us Barabbas. Those that he had healed and those that he had loosed and those that he had set free now lashed out in mockery. Oh, the shame that he endured when seemingly no one wanted him to live and the whole crowd wanted a murderer instead of a king. A king that had did nothing but good. This king that was anything but ordinary. First stripped of his clothes, then beaten with that cat of nine tails and chunks of his flesh lay withering on the ground. But this didn't look like a king because he was no ordinary king. A crown was placed upon his head, but it wasn't a golden crown with jewels placed in it signifying his power and his authority, but rather it was a crown of thorns pressing into his brow. You say, you're the king? Prove it. Come save yourself. Spit upon, beaten, humiliated, weak from the whipping and loss of blood, he was forced to carry his own cross. Say this cross weighed up to 300 pounds. Been hard for a strong man to carry, let alone someone that had been beaten within an inch of their life. Being so weak that he couldn't even carry his own cross, he collapsed under the weight of this cross. And a bystander, Simon by name, had to pick it up and carry it from him. I can just picture in my mind's eye a blood trail everywhere that God went. Every footstep left a bloody footprint as he made his way to Golgotha. How many went home that day that had stepped where Jesus had trod and gotten blood on their shoes and blood on the fringes of their garment? I can imagine even Simon, after carrying the cross that Jesus had carried, his hands gripped the cross where Jesus gripped it at. His shoulder rested where Jesus' shoulder had rested, and the blood that Jesus shed fell down and maybe got on his cheek and run down his garment. I wonder what went through his mind when he went home and he looked in the mirror and he saw the precious blood of Jesus Christ staining his skin, staining his clothes. Man, what a king. This was no ordinary king. It was the blood that would save a multitude from their sins. Laid him on a cross and they pounded. They didn't gently do it. They pounded spikes on his wrists and his ankles and suspended him between heaven and earth. It was there that he faced agony for 6 long hours. Hurting. Wounded. This was no ordinary king. He'd done this for you. He'd done this for me. It was there that he was writhing in agony and pain and trying his best to breathe and trying his best just to live as long as he could. And finally, this inscription above him said King of the Jews, but he didn't look like the King of the Jews. This wasn't an ordinary king. He didn't look like a king. But finally, and I could just picture, if you could peel the clouds away, I could see all of heaven, all 72,000 angels plus, standing at attention, tears. And I believe if angels could cry, probably heaven was filled with a river of angel tears as they watched the one that they loved give his life for someone that didn't love him. And finally, he had finally got to the point that he said, it's enough. I can finally give up life. And oh, the power that was said when he screamed out, it is finished. And all of a sudden the earth began to shake. Lightning began to happen. People began to stand back and say, hold on. Something just happened. Behold, maybe this was the Son of God. Maybe this was the King of the Jews. Now the bloodlust for the kill is over. Stark realization that this truly is the Son of God is now upon them all. So gingerly they take him off the cross, wrap him up, and place him in a borrowed tomb. He had told his followers, said, destroy this temple in 3 days and build it back in 3 days. But they didn't realize what he was really talking about. He was talking about himself. The power that they had seen this king possess, now it seems like it's over. He had miracle working power, and I've watched him change lives. I've watched him heal the sick. I've watched him raise the dead. And now it's over. Now it's gone. All right. He had never had any characteristics of an earthly king, but now it seems like he is like every other king, because once every other king dies, their power's over with, and that power is handed to someone else. But this king now seems to be just like every other king, but it ain't over yet. For the agony and the wound and the blood and everything that he went through was just leading up for this point and this moment of time that we celebrate today. And they would soon discover that this was no ordinary king. And again, I could picture those angels standing around waiting on the countdown. They knew what was about to happen. They knew what was about to take place as they waited anxiously, and that clock would say 3 days and 2 days and 24 hours left and 6 hours. How much more time now, Gabriel? It says 2 hours and 59 minutes. Can't wait. Before long, we're going to get to be with Jesus once again. And they watched it. 3, 2, 1. Matthew chapter 28 and verses 2 through 4. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning. His raiment was as white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and become as dead men. Those that were watching and guarding the tomb, those that were trying their best to keep Jesus locked up in the tomb, could no longer keep him in the tomb any longer. And just like that, he proved he wasn't like any other king. For Revelation 1 and 18 says, "For I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore." Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. Not only does God have the keys to heaven, not only does he have the keys to good things, but he has the power over every bad thing that's happened to you in your life. He has power over death and hell. Begin to wonder, why 3 days? Why couldn't God not have been buried and one day later arise up? Why could he not have been buried just for 2 days and all of a sudden come back to life? Because it wouldn't make him any more dead 3 days versus one day. Why would he wait 3 days? I'm going to do a little research and try to understand. And I know that God had the power to be raised to life at any point in time in his life. I understand that prophecies went forth of old times that said it would be 3 days. And so he fulfilled scripture by being rose up from the dead in 3 days. But why could they have not prophesied 2 days or one day? I began to read that it was a Jewish tradition that they would go and check the grave after 3 days, because there were reports in the Talmud that stated that there were times they would go in to check after 3 days to make sure that they were dead and that person would be alive. How scary would that be? So what God was saying, I'm going to go past and beyond when they say it's time for me to die. If I come back in 2 days, they're going to say, well, he never died anyways. But God said, I want to make sure that you know that I'm dead. I want you to make sure and understand that I can come back to life and I can defeat death and I can defeat hell. Got to make sure he's dead because he's got something to prove. Remember years ago when I first started hunting, I was a young boy. And I just had finally got to the point where Dad and Uncle Stacy and them would let me hunt by myself. Here I was sitting in the stand, not knowing everything there was to know about hunting. And here walked this buck deer. He was an 11 point. He was a spike deer. It had two little spikes sticking up. Man, I had never killed a buck at this point in time. And he walked out there not far from me. And I was nervous. I was shaking. I pulled my gun up and poof. Man, when I shot, that deer flipped head over heels. Man, just hit the ground. Man, I am a shot and a half. And then all of a sudden, that deer jumped up, took off running, and ran smack dab into a tree so hard. He was running at full speed, just ran right into a tree and flipped head over heels and landed again. And I ain't never seen a deer do that before. Then the deer got up, and he just stood there. And he was just standing there, and he was just doing this number right here. He's standing on all four legs, just shaking that head like this right here. That deer looks funny. I pulled my scope up and zeroed in on those horns because they had told me, said, son, now if a deer comes out, you got to make sure they're 1.5 inches, 2 inches long or the horns or it's illegal and game warden will get us. And I scoped it in and sure enough, they weren't long enough. I thought, oh, Jesus, please let this deer live. I could just imagine the game warden sitting out there by our truck and me pulling this deer in and saying, oh, okay, sorry. So I was praying, saying, God, let this deer live. Let him live. Let him live. Come to find out, I'd shot its horn clean off its head. Knocked that deer slap dab unconscious. It was legal till I got a hold of it. And I let that deer walk away that day. But I learned from that time forward to when you kill a deer, it could be laying there like that one was laying there. And when you walk up to it, you make sure it's dead. And one of the ways you can do it is take that gun barrel and touch its eyeball. If its eyeball blinks, you know he's still alive. I've always been scared to death. What am I going to do if it blinks, you know? I hadn't had one to blink yet, but I don't know what I'll do if it is. But you got to make sure it's dead. And God said, I'm going to make sure I'm dead so that you can take something that's dead and lifeless and prove to you I can bring it back to life again. Sometimes God wants you to understand and realize that circumstances is out of your control. That you can't explain it away and you can't fix it. You can't make it right. You can make it come and get a little bit of breath back into it and finally get it up on its feet again. No, that's God was proving to us that he can take something that's dead and lifeless and without hope and without anything. Because God only gets the glory with something that stinks. He can take somebody that's got their life all together. And he can take someone that's got just everything just right and he can fill them with the Holy Ghost and change their life, but it's not going to be near the impact unless he takes somebody up off the bottom and takes somebody out of the gutter that's been addicted and homeless and broken and life messed up. He gets more glory out of that one than he does the other. And sometimes he wants you to understand that your situation may stink, but God can still bring redemption to your life. He would go to Lazarus. We know the story of Lazarus that God raised back up from the dead. Lazarus in John 11:39, Jesus told him and said, take you away the stone. Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said unto the Lord, Lord, by this time he stinketh. Stinks. Why would we open up something that's just going to stink? He's been dead for 4 days. You see, God sometimes won't get the glory out of it unless it does stink. Your situation may stink. Your finances may stink. Your relationships may stink. Your addictions stink. Nobody wants to be around you because of your life and your chaos that's in your world. But God can walk into a place that's full of odor and full of mess ups and full of mistakes and full of death. And God can say, be raised back to life again. And by the mere mention of his word and the opening of his mouth, he can bring life back to your situation today. Some of you walked in here this morning with a mess on your hands. You walked in here broken and beat up and your life's so out of whack it don't even make sense to you anymore. But I've come today to tell you that God can bring life back into your life. God can give you peace of mind and God can give you strength for your body. You may be battling addictions. You may have family members that's battling addictions. But I'm here today to tell you, when you call out their name to Jesus, he's no ordinary king. He can go to where they are. He can walk into your life and break addictions. Seemed like every prayer here lately around church has been about people that's battling addictions. It seemed never before as in a time of life has people been battling addictions like they have in this day and age that we live. The devil grabs hold of people and attaches things and weights and sin to their life, and they can't seem to get rid of it. They don't want it. They try, but they can't do it because they are addicted to things. But God can break free addictions. I've watched people come into the altar of church and be broken full of addictions and pour their heart out to God and say, God, I can't do it by myself. And God help them and God give them strength. The Bible tells us that with man it may be impossible, but with God are all things possible. You may be battling addictions. You may be battling relationship problems. You may be fighting battles that nobody else can see, battling depression and anxiety, something we don't talk about from the pulpit near enough. Battles between those ears. Battle of the mind that you sit around and cry without even having a reason to cry. And you don't understand why that you're going through the anxiety and depression that we're going through. But I'm here today that the God we serve, He's no ordinary king. He can lift you up out of depression. He can lift those anxiety feelings off of your life. Because God is a God of resurrection. Let's all stand all across this house. Other kings you could only approach if they allowed you or they beckoned for you to approach. You can't walk in nonchalant to another king's throne room and just walk up to him and talk to him. But this is no ordinary king. All you got to do is walk up to him with your hands raised and saying, Jesus, I love you. And this king will meet you where you are. So could we do that right now as musicians come? Lift our hands all across this house and let's pray that God, would you visit with us just for a moment right now. To every broken heart, to every broken spirit, to every wounded soul that's here today. God, would you meet with us today? For we understand that we need you today more than ever. We need your hand to come and to move upon us. Thank you, Lord, that we serve a king that's not so ordinary. That God, we can come to you and you can fight the battles for us. In Jesus' name. Now, could we give this King of Kings and the Lord of Lords a hand clap of praise? Amen. Go ahead and ring our buzzer if you hadn't already. Let our classes come on back out. Ushers are going to make their way around and give you an opportunity to give of tithes and our offerings. Our little ones here all the time, every Sunday morning, and we don't want to miss them this morning. So all of our King's kids come sing big and loud today. All of our King's kids, we've got a big number today. All of our guests, welcome to come join with them this morning.
Dad and I are just going to let go. All right, now, if you want to be treated like an adult, you're going to have to start acting like one.
Fine. What is there to talk about? I've already made up my mind, and there's nothing that you can do to change it.
Look here, young lady. You may be old enough to drive, but that does not mean that you could just come in here and say whatever you want to say to us. As long as you're living under this roof, you're going to abide by my rules. Do you understand that?
Fine. I mean, I can move out. I'm sure there's somebody else I could go live with.
Brenna, honey, what has gotten into you? Why don't you want to go to church anymore? You have always loved going to church ever since you were a little girl. What has changed?
I just don't want to go anymore, okay? You and Dad have made me go to church every single service my entire life. And for once, I just want to make my own decision. It's not that somebody's done something or that they've said anything. I just want to make my own decision about this. I mean, I don't want to hurt you and Dad. I just wish that you would let me make my own decision.
Brenna, honey, I really, really want you to think about what you're saying. And I want you to think about all the times that God has been there for you and he has gave his time for you. I know we don't have much time to talk about it today, but we will talk about more of this in the morning, okay?
But...
No buts about it. We're going to talk more about it in the morning. And Brenna, please know that your dad and I, we love you, and we just want what's best for you, okay?
Okay.
Good night.
Lady, wake up.
Who are you? What are you doing here?
I'm looking for the King of the Jews.
Well, are you crazy? Jesus was born like 2,000 years ago. Besides, why would he be here now?
I'm sorry. Thank you for your help.
This is crazy. Okay, maybe it's just a dream.
Where is he? Jesus!
What is happening?
Please, tell me, have you seen Jesus anywhere?
What is it with you people? Listen, someone just asked me that. He's not here.
Oh, please, you've got to help us. He's only 12 years old. We were celebrating the Passover, and I thought he was right behind us. Please, have you seen him anywhere? Help us.
No, he's not here. Listen, if I remember correctly, you will find him. Just go back to the temple. He's there teaching. Wait, what am I saying? That was a long time ago. Listen, he's not here now.
Thank you so much.
Well, I guess I'm not getting any sleep tonight. Oh, man, please. What is going on? What next?
Repent!
Oh, let me guess. You must be John the Baptist.
And how did you know?
Well, for starters, your coat is made out of camel's hair. You look like you just came from the wilderness. And you're walking around yelling about repentance. Oh, and thanks but no thanks, I've already been baptized.
Yes, I indeed did baptize you with water unto repentance. But he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He will baptize you with the Holy Ghost and with fire.
Oh, fire, huh? Well, listen, I'm going to start yelling fire if you don't get out. My parents are going to wake me up in the morning, and they're going to try to make me go to church, and I would like to have enough energy to fight with them about it. So please, just leave.
If you insist.
What is going on with me? Wake up, Brenna, wake up. Okay, so after John the Baptist... Then Jesus being tempted by the devil. Oh no, oh no, oh no, oh no. Oh, Lord, please, please help me go to sleep.
Oh. Oh.
Ma'am. Ma'am, are you okay?
Please, tell me, have you seen Jesus?
Listen, Jesus is not here. Can I call you a doctor or something?
There's no use. No doctor has healed me yet in 12 years, and no one never will. I just need to find Jesus.
No, listen. I'm calling you a doctor. Hello? No, I need some help. Somebody please come help me. Jesus?
Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. Jesus, have mercy on me. Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me.
Bring him to me. What can I do for you?
That I might receive thy sight.
Thy faith hath made thee whole. Be healed.
I can see.
He can see.
I can see.
He can see.
I can see.
He can see.
I can see.
Woman, be loose from thine infirmity.
Let me tell you what Jesus did for me and my sister. I heard Jesus was coming into town, and I thought my brother Lazarus had died. But I know and still know that whatsoever you ask of God, he will do. Jesus told me my brother would rise again, but I thought he meant at the resurrection. At the last day, Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? What else could I do but told him he spoke the truth? I believed him. He went to Lazarus' grave and rose him from the dead after 4 whole days. My sister Mary was there with me. We were so excited. Jesus is a healer. I seen it with my own eyes.
He performed so many miracles while he was here. But why do I care? It's not like I need anything. I don't need a miracle. I don't need a healing. I can handle my problems all on my own. Now, if I could just get some sleep. No, 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 please stop it. Please stop. No, please. No, he didn't do anything. You have to stop this. No, please stop it. No, please. Please, what are you doing? Please stop this. Please, no, 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 no. Please stop. No.
No. Jesus. Stop. No.
Die. It is finished. Was the Son of God.
I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Why would you do that? I promise I'll live for you. I promise I'll spend the rest of my life loving you. I have no idea why you would do that. I'm so sorry. Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, I love you so much. Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry.
Sweetie, are you okay?
Oh, Mom, what happened?
Well, I was about to ask you the same thing. How did you wind up in the floor? Did you have a bad dream?
A bad dream? I don't know what it was. It was like the Bible. It was like I was a part of it, but I wasn't a part of it. But it was like Jesus. He was right here.
Oh, honey, he is here. Listen, I know that you don't want to go to church anymore, but that doesn't mean that Jesus is just going to fall off the face of the earth. If you remember, he died on the cross, but he rose again. So yes, he is here. He's everywhere. All you have to do is just reach out to him. Now come on, why don't we get ready for church?
Okay. Mom,
yeah.
I'm so sorry about last night. You know, I know that Jesus loves me, and I know what he did for me, and I know that he suffered and died for me. I guess I just took it for granted, and I never really appreciated it. But to think that he went through all of that just to come back and to be with people like me who don't even deserve it, why would he do that?
Jesus conquered death, hell, and the grave. He not only gave himself on that cross for you, but 3 days later, he arose and ascended into heaven. He has gone to prepare a place for me and you and you and you. He's alive, and he's right here in this room today. Can you feel him? Can you feel his love as it covers you this morning? The resurrected King is resurrecting you and me, and he wants us to come alive in him.
Your name is victory. All praise will
Let's all stand to our feet and give the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords a hand clap of praise. As you're clapping your hands, would you lift your voice and magnify Him? Come on, let's let a praise erupt from this place today. God, you're worthy. Lord, worthy of praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. We praise your name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for resurrection power. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus. Doesn't feel good to be in God's presence. God doesn't want to just visit you on Easter. He wants to visit you every day of your life. Those of you that do not have a home church, we invite you to come back, be a part of DPC with us. We're open every Sunday and every Wednesday night, and we invite you to come back, be with us. We're so honored that you are here today. You might be seated. We're going to get away and get into our giveaways. And then we'll step outside and have an Easter egg hunt.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Easter. We want to thank everybody for coming this morning. We do have some giveaways. It'll take us just a couple of minutes to get everything set out. Okay, if you have a child with you this morning that did not go to a Sunday school room, please raise your hand so that I can make sure I got your child's name in the bucket. If you did not go, I got you, got Paisley, I got Dallas, I got Willow, I got Archer, I got Sunday. Okay, so I think I got everybody. All right. We had to get something for the little ones, too, so we got puffs. All right, so we are going to draw two boys and two girls from each age group for some of our smaller prizes, and then we're going to give our big prizes away, okay? So with our little ones, right here, you want to draw or let me get somebody? Boys, girls. We're going to draw two or three total out of each group for boys and girls. Brian. And Dallas. You want an elephant or a gator? Because Dallas doesn't care. We'll take one on this side. All right. All right, and now for our girls, Parker Bethune. And Aubrey Turpin. If these are a little small for them, they came from Walmart. All right, now for our bigger prizes is our big stuffed animal. We have Paisley Wyatt. And Sawyer Austin. All right, our next age group we've got right here. Miles Hopper. And Ridgeland Osier. Kickballs. And then our girls are going to be Lily Lomax. And Kylie Herndon. And then whichever stuffed animal the girls want to pick out. The next group. Or do the big ones. All right, this is for our bicycles in this group. Oh. Come here and pick you out a stuffed animal. You want this puppy dog or the blue puppy dog? Want the blue one? Lily, which one you want? This puppy dog or this one? That one? Okay. There you go. All right, so for our bicycles for this age group, we have Leanne Lomax. This will be your bicycle sister. And River Osier. All right, our next age group. All right, with this age group, we only have two boys in this age group, guys, so we need to get some more boys in here this age group. So we're going to draw three girls for the small ones. So we've got Lily Etheridge, London Cheney, and Trinity Turpin. All right, you get to pick a kickball or figured you would take that or a stuffed animal. Here you go, sister. All right, so one boy gets kickball, one boy gets a bike. Weston Wyatt, come get your kickball. Tuff Funderburk, come get your bicycle. He's like, don't throw that at me. That's yours, buddy. That's your. You can leave it sitting there until after church, okay? All right, and for our girls' bicycle, Kenzie Herndon. Stephanie Wilkerson, did you have any extras in your class that I didn't get their name in here? No? Okay. All right, so for our older ones, we have Walmart gift cards. So the first two gets a $5 card. The other gets a $25 card. Lorelai. And Ava Northcutt. There you go, sister. And for the big one, Memphis Mayo. There you go, sister. Uh-huh. All right, so our first $5 Walmart card, Landon Cheney. Second one is Ripken Williams. And our $25 one goes to Adrian Funderburk. You have to come up here to get it. You want me to draw another name? You're going to give away $25 just to not come up here, just right here. All right, Mom, should I draw another name? I'm just kidding. I'm not going to. We'll give it to him later. I'm going to turn it back over to Pastor.
Granddad will just take that with him. Thank you for being here today. Didn't everyone do a great job? Can we give everybody a hand? Thank all of you. I am so blessed to be pastor of the greatest church around. And I tell you what, I would be more blessed if you come all the time with us. Amen. We have a great church here, a great group of people, and I do say thank all of you that have got all this stuff together, and they've worked really hard. We've stuffed eggs, and we're going to have a big egg hunt out here, and I think there's some prize eggs out here also, so we're going to have a good time. Would you stand together with us one more time? Great word from Brother Brent, assistant pastor of our church. We love my son. Amen. Didn't he do a good job? Amen. And all you beautiful children, we're so blessed to have you. And we pray that you would remember that Jesus is the reason. No greater love than this, that a man would lay down his life for his friends. And remember, Jesus gave it all for you. If you weren't touched by this skit and play that we had today, you just got an old stony heart. But God can take that stony heart away and give you a heart of flesh. Praise God. Thank you for being here. Would you lift your hands together and pray and thank the Lord for this season? God, we love you. We thank you so much for everything that you've done. God, we thank you for this day that we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, our great God and our great King. Go with this congregation. Keep us safe, Lord. Bless the remainder of this day. And we honor you and praise you for it in Jesus' name. Everyone say amen. Amen. God bless you. As you go out, they will get with you and line you up and put you with which group you're to be on the outside. Go around to the north side. God bless you.